Well, his father unfortunately died when Dad was about six, but he had a very loving mother and he had a wonderful grandfather who really cared for them and bought them all sorts of things like bikes, and he was quite a wealthy man. And he started school at the Mundingburra Primary School, where my mother was also a pupil. And then from there he went to the Townsville Grammar School, but he felt he wasn't getting the education that he needed there. After a few years he left and he had a, I suppose you'd call him a tutor, and he was the man that encouraged him to apply for Duntroon. But as a young man he was very adventurous.
Before Sir Lawrence turned 21, he was, having left Duntroon, he was one of 12 airmen that were sent across to Egypt to fly aircraft and work in a war that must have seemed to him something that was not only dangerous, not only caring about others, but here he was a long, long way from home, establishing himself as a young man in his life. So he was asked to go, and of course he was never one not to volunteer. He was always the first one to volunteer for any sort of mission, and this was quite a dangerous mission indeed. He and his backup one-man crew, who was also the photographer, went behind enemy lines to photograph the various things that they needed photographing, and that was a pretty dangerous mission, and they had a lot of gunfire, a lot of ammunition that went into their aircraft. As they were coming back from the mission, there were something like 80 bullet holes in the plane. The plane was pretty badly beaten up. They were in fact very lucky to survive that. And as a result of that expedition and many others that he'd flown before, he was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross, the DFC. He enjoyed what he was doing, but the war was coming to an end, and I think he felt now that the time was to move on to other things.
When the war finished, Dad was invited to stay in England to learn a little bit about aircraft design. And then they came back. It was still the Australian Flying Corps, but the Royal Australian Air Force was formed in 1921. Dad wanted to stay in Sydney and do something about aircraft. So there was a factory that was due during the war at Randwick in Sydney, and that was bought by the government, and the experimental station, the RAF experimental station, was started there. He built the Widgeons, Widgeon 1, Widgeon 2, and the little Warrigal. Well, to start off the aircraft industry, I think he was originally appointed because Sir Richard Williams, who was flying with him in Egypt and was still in the Air Force at the time, they were looking, I think BHP, Essington Lewis and Sir Harold Darling, I think Sir Richard Williams, well, he was not knighted at the time, but he was one of the senior Air Force officers, suggested that they interview Dad and that he would be the one to guide the aircraft industry. And that's how I think that started.
Sir Lawrence was very fervent about the importance of manufacturing industry in Australia. And for him it was with aircraft design and construction. He believed strongly that it was important for our defence as a nation. We are an island in the middle of nowhere, and it's important that we protected our own borders with our own designs and construction of equipment.
Well, I think he felt that Australia was so isolated, and he could see the threat of the Japanese coming down. That's why he was so wrapped up in his ambitions to produce aircraft that could protect us, necessarily.
During the Second World War, Sir Lawrence presided over an industry that 3 years previously hadn't even existed, and which went on to employ 10,000 people at its factory at Fisherman's Bend in Victoria. And that business also produced hundreds of aircraft for Australia's manufacturing industry. Yeah, Sir Lawrence realised that when the war was ended, that meant that aircraft construction was going to decline dramatically, and so it did. And that meant, therefore, of course, that without any substitute manufacturing at the Commonwealth Aircraft Corporation, that there would be less people employed. And so he turned his mind to other pursuits, not only to keep those people employed, but to also provide production and needs for the Australian consumers to use. Time and time again, Sir Lawrence had to negotiate with superiors to get results. Many, many occasions he felt thwarted by that, he felt let down by that, but he always came out a winner. And history would show that he was far-sighted. In fact, he wrote that he had to fight intrigues single-handed. Sir Lawrence was directly responsible for the development of an airframe from America for the Sabre, and then sourcing an Avon engine from England. And by bringing those two elements together, it was able to produce something that was just magical for Australian manufacturing industry, and gave the Royal Australian Air Force the most advanced fighter in the world at that time.
Sir Lawrence Wackett was regarded as the founder of the Australian aircraft industry.
Sir Lawrence Wackett, my grandfather, was one of the towering figures of the aircraft industry in Australia. He was extraordinarily innovative, he was extraordinarily intelligent, and he set the pattern for the future of manufacturing industry in this country.